Thanks so much for tuning into Talking Point. I'm your host, Neeraj Shah. And I think the equity markets are at a stage wherein it's important to get some advice about how some of the sharpest minds are thinking about the near-term challenges versus the long-term opportunities. And could a host of factors impact the markets a wee bit in the near term? I think that'll be a moot point of the question, but there'll be a lot more that we will talk to with Mr. Krishna Kumar Karwa. He joins in right now, needs no introduction really, with his thoughts on how the markets are set to move ahead and how does he view them at the current juncture. Mr. Karwa, good having you. Thanks for joining in. Hope all is safe. What's your sense really about how the market could be viewed currently? Because there's this fear of a re-emanating of lockdowns, if you will, in some fashion. The conversation has started in Maharashtra, maybe some other parts. We're already seeing that happening in the rest, some parts of the rest of the world continuing. And now there's this talk of the rising bond yields and what if inflation comes back and what it could do to valuation multiples. So how does that stack up against the probability of a strong budget and earnings growth in India?
Good morning, Neeraj, and good morning to all your viewers. Yeah, you have raised a whole host of questions in the opening remarks. So coming back to, I think, let's look at the background first, which is that if you look at the broad indices, on a one-year basis, they have given around 25% returns. If you look at them in terms of the last 6 months, then the returns are, say, more than 30%. And if you look at from 1st Jan itself, the indices have given almost 7-8%. If you look at the quarterly numbers which have come out for the quarter three, they are very, very robust numbers. They have many companies, I would say 2/3 of the companies have beaten analyst expectations, and there have been good upgrades as far as future forecasts are concerned. So the dilemma today investors are facing is that yes, there is some rise in bond yields in the US, and also we are seeing that happening locally. And even oil prices being where they are, I mean, there's almost at $65, and inflation has also seems to be on the uptick, at least as overseas is concerned. So investors are sitting on huge gains on a one-year basis, on a six-month basis, and even from 1st Jan itself. So the temptation to book profits is very high, looking at the slightly deteriorating macros, which is rising interest rates or inflation. But at the same time, if you look at the corporate performance and the projections for the corporate performance going forward, then I believe that investors should be taking some short-term correction in their stride and stay invested. I think the next two, three years, as far as Indian economy is concerned and Indian capital market is concerned, there seems to be a clear run. The capex cycle already is on. You can hear from almost all corporates that they are increasing capacities. If you speak to cap good companies, they are seeing increasing order inflows. From the government perspective, I think they have put their best foot forward in the budget, and the pronouncement from the Prime Minister also, where he has emphasized the need for public sector units to be run by private entrepreneurs and not by bureaucrats, and the importance of the private sector in the overall scheme of things. So net-net, I would say that yes, in the short term, there could be some profit taking, there could be some sector churn which may happen, but investors need to be fully invested. They can do some sector rotation, but they need to be fully invested as per their equity allocation in equities. Because I believe from the next 2-3 year perspective, we are poised for some decent gains, even from these relatively elevated levels.
Okay, can I ask you a tactical question though, Mr. Karwa? Do you reckon, I mean, because you serve such a large set of institutional clients as well, and the institutional flow both locally and globally is just looking like ebbing a little bit from the highs that we had. So compare fund flows with the near term issues and wrinkles that we have. I agree that maybe investors should take the correction in the stride, but do you reckon that a correction is in the offing, and could this correction be material, or would it be to the tune of 4, 5, 7%, which will get bought into? What's your What's your judgment?
So my sense is that even during the last 6-9 months, you have already seen sectoral corrections or sectoral time consolidation happening. So even if you look at now, say in the last 40 or 45 days, if you will see, pharma companies seem to be kind of taking a breather, and there has been some price correction. And even on the last 6 months basis, pharma companies have actually underperformed because they had their run before that. So my take is that you will possibly see this kind of sectoral corrections, or you could also see some kind of consolidation, if not price corrections. And in terms of, instead of focusing on how the broad indices are correcting or how they are behaving, I think investors would do very well to be very, very sharply bottoms up in their portfolio. In terms of the calls that they take on their portfolio should be more stock specific rather than getting taken in by the macros. There could be price corrections, but I think it's going to be more of a temporary kind of a phenomenon. Even in raging bull markets, you have seen that markets can correct by 10-15%. Having said that, I think whole host of investors have got left out because they just couldn't believe the rally which has taken place from, say, 7,500-8,000 levels to today, it's around 15,000 levels. And they have been waiting for these corrections. They have been waiting for confirmation from, in terms of how economic performance improves. They have been waiting for corporate performance. And now they are waiting for the price corrections to happen. So my sense is that every correction will be bought into. Yes, what you said in terms of domestic global flows, possibly they are ebbing, which is okay, which is fine, and which is very healthy also, because a vertical rise would not be very good for the overall long-term health of the market. As far as domestic, I think there is a clear, so the SIPs, as far as domestic mutual funds are concerned, they are very robust. So the faith in the equity markets continues with the large retail, with the retail investors. What we are seeing is redemptions could be the lump sum part of it, the lumpy investments, which are some people are timing and they are taking some money off the table. But that's fine. I think we are seeing a lot of direct investing, which is happening. The retail participation is at all-time high. So broadly, I'm not too sure about whether investors are, you should be worrying too much about flows at the current environment. I think investors should be more focused on the individual stocks that they own, the valuation at which they are buying, and the prospects for them in the coming few years.
Well, actually, speaking of valuations, I think what the market seems to have latched on to are PSUs, isn't it? Now, you mentioned about this Prime Minister's mention as well about how public sector units should be run by private and not bureaucrats, etc. Do you reckon this is a turn, a definite turn for how the markets and investors perceive some of the high quality or higher quality PSU units, if I can call it that? It'll be a very bottom-up thing, but still, would you believe that this is a bit of a turn and you could see that significant wealth creation over the next 12 to 24 months in PSUs?
See, I think the devil is always in the detail and it's all about execution. So the intentions of the government are very clear in terms of divesting, privatizing a whole host of public sector units. How successful are they in able to execute that in the next coming 12 to 24 months? That is something which is the key to watch at. So we have been seeing BPCL divestment has been on for some time. Maybe it was because of COVID, etc. It has not yet happened. But one or two such successful divestments will give more leg to the PSU rally, which we are witnessing as of now. As far as the size and scale of many of these PSU, the kind of monopoly position that many of them have, the kind of assets that they have, there is no doubt about it. And if you go back in history and look at how Hindustan Zinc transformed after it was privatized, or even, why are we forgetting, even Maruti was a public sector company before it went public and was handed over to Suzuki to run the company. When we have seen the kind of efficiencies, transformation, these companies, the kind of shareholder wealth that these companies have created over the years. So my sense is that there is huge amount of value in public sector units. It is all about how it is unlocked, how successful are they in getting private, global and local entrepreneurs, private equity funds, etc. to run these companies, and how the unions, etc. are carried along. See, India is a democracy and there is a lot of resistance, and rightly so, because everybody has a voice. So a successful divestment of few marquee public sector units should give more leg to the rally. There is no doubt about the value that these units have. The sustainability of this rally would be a function of, as I said, execution.
But the question is, since investing would be about building a hypothesis and then testing if it turns out true or no, would you, in your, you are now no longer just on the sell side, right? You guys run a buy side operation as well. Would you be tempted to maybe invest some money, or tell some of your large investors to invest some money in an OMC or a PSU bank, because those are the forefront of this divestment candidature, so to say, in FY22?
So yes, I think we are evaluating some of the opportunities in maybe the defense PSUs or the OMCs, etc. So the opportunities are there, and we are evaluating them in terms of whether to invest for our clients. And the temptation is to invest in some of these opportunities. But yes, we have to take baby steps, because there have been many false starts in the earlier times also. And it's a function of what mandates that we have for the various clients that we run. See, at the end of the day, we have to also respect the fact that until and unless there is a 100% divestment, or the management passes on to private sector, otherwise to bringing in the necessary efficiencies and value creation may not happen. So it's very, very important to see how these divestments take place and what kind of investors come in. So yes, we are evaluating. We are very hopeful that some of them will turn out to be great wealth creators. If there is only partial sale, etc., with the control staying being with the government, then I think there is a misalignment of interests, because the government has various objectives, including various social objectives. So sometimes capital allocation and capexes, etc., are not a function of pure shareholder wealth creation. So that is what keeps us, you know, slightly tempered in our enthusiasm of PSU that on an overall basis.
Fair call, and thanks for that answer. Viewers, just keep in mind, anything that Mr. Karwa would be speaking about would be indicative in nature. Do not take it as a statement of intent of investment for you to follow. Mr. Karwa, the other question is, actually, just before we get to other themes, because you mentioned that it's important to be thematic and bottom up, how are your portfolios doing, that the funds that you manage, but the money management, how is that side of the business doing? And are there some calls which you've taken which are slightly different or contrarian to the market currently?
So the basic theme that we follow in our portfolio is we have our own proprietary philosophy called equal risk, where we evaluate companies on various soft parameters, and we give a score to the company in terms of where does it stand in our scheme of things as far as management quality, disclosures, communications, etc. is concerned. And then we arrive at, okay, based on this score, what kind of returns the company should give us over the next 2-3 year period for it to justify to be a part of our portfolio. Now, what this has helped, and this has been evolved over the last 7-8 years, is that the quality of the portfolio in terms of management capabilities, etc., and management shareholder friendliness, I think it has been one of the, so we have had a very stellar portfolio. Even at the time when the markets were in mayhem in the month of March, April, and when the indices were sharply down, yes, our portfolio is also corrected, because obviously we have to value the portfolio based on market price. But we did not receive a single call from any of our investors in terms of worrying about the stocks in the portfolio, because they were all top quality compound companies in terms of the performance track record, in terms of balance sheets, etc. So investors were very comfortable that whenever things improve, these stocks will make a comeback, and rightly so. So if you look at our small cap offering, which is called MK Emerging Stars, I think they have delivered stellar returns in terms of outperforming the benchmark over the last 1 year basis since April. They're almost 25-30%. So I think we have done 120% kind of a return versus the benchmark, which have delivered some 85-90% return. But more than the benchmarking, I think what is important is the risk that we have taken, the churn that is minimal as far as the portfolio is concerned, which is what enthuses the investors. And in terms of obviously what kind of calls we have taken, I think it's not about the calls taken in the month of April, May or whatever. It was the kind of portfolio construct where we had stocks which we believe could deliver returns over a 2-3 year period. So I think the portfolio construction is very important, and slightly longer term view, and not looking at the returns that the stock can generate in the next 3 to 6 months. So there is no short term thinking as far as our portfolio construct is concerned. And that has done very well for us, and that is what has enthused our investors. And mind you, I think we are in the alternate investment space, where the investors are very, very sophisticated. They are looking at concentrated portfolios, and I think that their needs are very different. So they are not looking at only benchmark investing. They are looking at absolute returns. They are looking at risk-adjusted returns. So we have to take care of a lot of requirements of the clients when we are constructing these portfolios. And to some extent, there is a lot of customization also which happens based on the client requirements.
I'm certain that that would be the case. Can I ask you, at a larger scale, between choosing companies which are trading at substantially high FY21 or trading 12 months multiples, but showing potential of earnings growth, versus companies that are available at a very decent valuation right now, what would the overarching choice be? I know, again, it will be very bottoms up, but largely, do you reckon that you are buying earnings growth well into the future, or are you more comfortable buying value available on the table currently?
Yeah, I think it is now. It's not a question of that or this, either or. I think it is a question of getting what you call growth at a reasonable price. So I would say that you just can't end up buying stocks which you think are value plays without having any visibility on what kind of growth that these companies will deliver over the next 2-3 year period. So there has to be a good amount of visibility as far as growth is concerned. And you just can't buy growth at any valuations, because then the returns may not be there. The company will continue to deliver, as far as its performance is concerned. But the high valuations that you have paid, or your high entry price, will not allow you to earn a good return as far as the stock price is concerned. So on a bottoms-up basis, what we look at is obviously once the stock falls into our scheme of things as far as the equal risk parameters are concerned, is what are we paying for in terms of the next 2-3 year growth. Now, to answer your question in terms of what will you favor, I think it is always going to be slight bias in favor of growth. Because at the end of the day, equity investing is investing into growth. You just can't buy into value not having any visibility as far as how growth is going to come. Because we have seen that sometimes this kind of contraplays may not play out. The value can become further value and further value. Why go far? Today we are so positive and bullish on PSUs. But some of these PSUs today, I mean, the last 4-5 years, they have been value plays. And what was value became more valuable and more valuable, because there was no light at the end of the tunnel in terms of how value will get unlocked. Or now that there has been this announcement for thought process on privatizing, we are seeing value getting unlocked. And it makes sense to evaluate these companies from that perspective. So I think it is all about what is the trigger point as far as value stocks are concerned for value to get unlocked. Or what is the trigger point for growth to come in? without growth prospects or visibility to invest into value, I think will not deliver returns as far as shareholders are concerned.
Okay, so where is it that you're finding growth at reasonable price currently? You mentioned that sectorally some sectors are taking a breather, some are not. Let's ignore what the stocks have done or have not done thus far. Where is it that you find that there is growth at reasonable price available? Which pockets, which themes, which sectors?
So looking at the way the economy is reviving, I think there is still a lot of opportunity as far as the banks and the NBFCs are concerned. I think there the valuations of many of the NBFCs and banks are still very, very reasonable for the growth visibility that they offer in the next 2-3 years. Their capital adequacy is also very good. Most of them have raised equity, so they don't have challenges on growth. So my sense is that sector still in the next, from a next 3 year perspective, can offer very good compounded. And I'm not talking only of the top 2-3 banks. I think there is value, there is an opportunity for growth, and the valuations are in your favor for even in the second tier banks, whether they be the new generation private banks or even some of the old generation private banks. Yes, in the next few quarters, there would be some more recognitions, etc., once the RBI directives are complied with in terms of the NPAs, etc. But they have broadly provided in terms of pro forma NPAs and provisions have been taken, robust balance sheets, good growth opportunities. So I think that is one segment where you still need to be. If you are not invested in it, you can still get invested in, and there could be opportunities over there. Otherwise, I think the automobile sector, I think there are a lot of tailwinds. There are stock-specific opportunities over there based on a turnaround of performance. Some of the businesses have got a lot of visibility in terms of the next 2-3 years. And in terms of one of the corporates over there, I think there are a lot of talk in terms of tailwinds of the business, also a lot of focus on capital allocation. So I think the automobile sector again offers you some good opportunities to play the sector. Apart from this, I think another sector where I believe that the valuations are still very, very reasonable is the real estate sector. I think that sector is coming out of almost 7-8 years of consolidation. We have seen the kind of demand pickup which has happened in the last 4-5 months. The visibility seems to be, and there's a lot of consolidation which has happened. The weak players are out of the system. So you have some 8-10 players who are very, many of them are regional players. A few of them you can say that they are having a pan-India presence. So they will make the most out of it in terms of the opportunity. And that whole chain, no doubt, some of the stocks in the building material segment, etc., have appreciated. But that whole chain, I think, is poised for a very good uptick in the next 3-4 years. So I think that's where opportunity lies for investors. And lastly, I would say is that the capex cycle is picking up. So capital goods segment, I think they will be the first beneficiaries, and we are seeing some initial signs. So whether it be the bearings companies, whether it be the power gen generators over there, or pipes companies in that segment, I think there is a lot of opportunities for those kind of companies, to even digitization and automation companies in that segment. So I think the cap goods sector, they have also been in the doldrum because capex cycle was weak for the private sector for the last 5-6 years. And now I think most corporates are looking to expand, and order book position is improving. So that cap goods companies also should deliver very good returns. And yes, valuations, as you rightly said, there will be slightly elevated valuations. Markets will discount future earnings. But the call is that whether you're buying FY23 discounted earnings or whether you're buying FY22, as long as you are not buying into FY23 and FY24 discounted earnings, and if you are buying it at FY22 with scope to possibly average down, I think then it's fair point to buy.
Well, that's an interesting way to look at it. Okay. I have one final question. And that is on the themes that did really well when this whole advent of COVID started. and we spoke about pharma taking it a bit of a breather. What about telecom and technology? So TMT was the buzzword. It probably still is. If I hear what NASSCOM said or what the IT leaders said in that conversation, HCL Tech CEO saying that the industry could double in about 4 years or 5 years. And telecom is a bit of an enigma because we are waiting for that elusive price hikes to come about from an investor's perspective at least, but they don't seem to be coming around. What do you do with these two? They're a bit of a points to ponder, and they're confusing investors big time currently.
So we continue to like both the IT and the telecom sector, and my sense is that investors should be looking at the visibility that the IT sector has in terms of earnings for the next 3-4 years, the kind of growth that these guys can have because of the increasing need for corporates to go for digitization, cloud migration, etc. So the visibility of earnings for these companies is very good. Yes, the valuations of these companies have got elevated, market have discounted the elevated earnings to some extent. But from a compounding perspective and from the next 3-4 year perspective, I think these companies should deliver very good returns to investors. As far as telecom is concerned, I think you had the last telecom rate tariff hike in December 19. And you have seen the numbers that as more and more data usage increases, so corporates have been able to increase their ARPUs reasonably well. And as there's more migration happening from 3G to 4G, my sense is that this will continue. Now it's a three-player market, and I'm sure there will be a tariff hike coming in the next 3 months, 6 months, who knows. So my sense is that in a three-player market, there is a natural kind of a monopoly. Their returns, their EBITDA, etc. are improving. Stock prices sometimes do tend to consolidate. So this is what you are seeing. But from a two-year perspective, I think both the telecom majors who have raised resources and the standalone player, I think both should deliver very good returns because the inherent tailwinds are there in the sector. And availability of capital now is not an issue. And tariff hikes, whether they come, it's good. If they don't come, still I'm sure they will be able to increase their, every quarter and quarter, they are able to increase their output, which is what finally matters.
It does. But okay. Let's wait and watch how this shapes. But we got the highlight in the previous answer, Mr. Karwa. And it was lovely chatting with you today. A slightly extended conversation, but thanks so much for taking the time and speaking to us.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and wish you all the best.
Thank you. And viewers, thanks for tuning in to this leg of Talking Point.